Hi, I'm David Miles, and we're going to do things just a little bit differently on The Leader today. There's been a lot going on in the arts and culture world, from Taylor Swift dropping a surprise new album to the Tate gearing up for reopening next week, which our editorial column has called a symbolic sign of life returning to normal. So, for this episode, I'm joined by the Evening Standard showbiz journalist Lizzie Edmonds in London, and from LA, perhaps taking social distancing too far, is KT Tunstall. KT, I want to start with you. And you've been banging the drum for live music during this pandemic lockdown. I want to start by asking if you saw Nick Cave's live stream for Idiot Prayer this week.
Long, lonely rider across the sky. Seek out mysteries while you sleep.
It was really stark, really lonely, just him, a piano, and that massive expanse of a stage at Alexandra Palace with no audience. It's beautiful, but that's not a live gig, is it? It needs that audience.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's the thing that's been a massive challenge. First of all, the tech side of it for us artists has been a nightmare because A, the sound on a lot of these platforms is kind of altered. There's like, you know, inbuilt noise cancellation, which gets rid of your guitar. I mean, it's so weird. And then the other thing, of course, is that in between songs, it's just total silence. And I remember when I first went to Japan, someone said to me, don't freak out, but it's completely silent. They clap for 5 seconds and then it's just silent. And it was, that's exactly what it was like. And it makes you, it really kind of puts you on edge when you don't have that feedback loop when you're playing.
Are you missing that, Katie?
I am missing it. I mean, more than, to be honest, I've been touring solid for 15 years and I'm busier than I've ever been. And all I ever do is go, I wish I had some time at home. Well, I got that, right? What I really miss is that sharing aspect of your life, of your day, of seeing other people's faces. But also, you know, as an artist, as a musician, you're a hub for people. You're not it's not just about the music, you know. And that's what it is about these small venues as well. It's not just about being platforms for people to become massively famous. These are really important community hubs where people get together and see each other and hang out and meet people. And, you know, I think I've always felt that being at a gig, you can come away from that just feeling like anything is possible. That I miss.
Where would you have been if you hadn't been able to do those live gigs, Kate? Just starting out, maybe just you and some mates kicking around in a bar with a tiny audience in front of you.
Honestly, my heart breaks for new artists right now who were just on the cusp of releasing stuff, just starting to do shows and just starting to get some momentum with what they do, because that period of time when you're starting out as a musician is really tough. It requires a massive amount of self-belief to put yourself out there, to put your new music out there. And what you need is that approval from your burgeoning audience. And that's really, really difficult now for anyone in that position. And the hard thing is that you don't get many shots at that stuff. You know, it's tough anyway.
So, Kenny, how have you adapted and been able to change and stay connected with the audience through this pandemic?
Well, I'm going to do something interesting now to give you an example of what I've been doing, which is
I'm very nervous.
Don't be nervous. I'm going to go live on my Instagram, which is a private Instagram account with my Patreon fans. Hi, everybody. So they're all here now with us.
And so, hi, Kate's fans.
Hi. It's the Evening Standard. sorry, guys. Basically, well, I've had a real revelation during this time, because when I'm touring, I'm on the road, traveling somewhere, trying to find something to eat, doing my sound check, and then I'm doing my gig. And I'm doing my gig to maybe, you know, anywhere between a few hundred people and maybe a few thousand people if I'm opening up for a bigger artist or whatever. And I don't have an awful lot of energy during that day to communicate with fans. And of course, while I've been at home during this time, all the energy's there to do whatever I want to do. And I was like, how can I be communicating with fans at this time they can join me in any recording situation and I go live with them and they can just watch. So we did a session in Studio 3 in Sunset Sound Studios where Prince recorded Purple Rain. So weirdly, even though we're not seeing each other in person, I'm actually in touch with my fans way more.
I think a lot of artists have said that, you know, that the social media has come into its own in the past couple of months, and now you very much can interact with people in a kind of much easier way. So that's cool.
There was one thing I thought that was really good fun that you did do with your fans. Now, we've all been talking about Taylor Swift dropping this surprise album, but Katie, you dropped a surprise single when you did Wash Your Hands, didn't you? How did that come about? What were you thinking there?
Some director friends of mine were going to be doing this video with a bunch of celebrities, and it was with the UN about washing your hands and how to give a kind of informational song about what to do. And I started it, and then the whole thing fell apart. And I was like, this is great. I don't want to just waste it. And I did it all on my laptop, no instruments, no guitar, just a little mic, this little microphone and my laptop. And then I got amazing champion beatboxer Grace Savage to come and do a kind of breakdown section on it. And it was really also for families and for kids to help them have a mantra and understand what was going on. But it was so great because we did it for WaterAid and War Child, but WaterAid got in touch afterwards when I sent it to them, and they were like, Katie, your chorus is 20 seconds long. It's a perfect hand wash.
Awesome.
Yes. Completely unintentional, but it worked.
And of course, joining us, as I said earlier, is Lizzie Edmonds from the Evening Standard. Now, Lizzie, I've been listening to that Taylor Swift album, and like Katie said, the tone is quite downbeat, but it's had a massive impact already just on release, hasn't it?
Definitely, yeah. I mean, it's a huge departure from what a lot of people would have expected and know Taylor Swift for. It is much more quieter, yeah. It's much more subtle. Smile, black lipstick, sensual politics. When you are
young, they assume you know nothing. If there's any woman on the planet who can read a room, it's Taylor Swift. You know, she's just consummate, brilliant, professional, extremely talented writer. And I think that right now, while we're still in this situation, I did this amazing online BBC Global Questions with Herbie Hancock. I couldn't believe I was on. It was honestly, David, I was like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to speak. Hancock. But he was just amazing. And he said, you know, music is healing. Music is a healing force. And some people have sort of felt that's a bit of a woo-wah thing to say, but they're really feeling it in this time, that it's a medicinal force to listen to music and to actually use music to soothe you at a time like this.
We're still maybe going to get an album from Kanye as well, aren't we? Now he's been in the news quite a bit.
Yeah, let's talk about mental health a little bit, because it's important to mention that he is bipolar. He does suffer from bipolar disorder, and he's obviously been struggling and suffering throughout whatever he's been trying to achieve here in the States. It's been really difficult to watch because it's a really extremely pivotal moment in history right now about what's going to happen to the future of the country for the next 4 years. So it's quite difficult to sort of use all the empathy for this, because it just does feel like it's very distracting at a really difficult time. But he's a very talented and very, I don't think he's an ill-meaning person, and he makes brilliant music. I did tweet out when he said he was running for president that I was really hoping that actually he'd pretended that he was really good friends with Trump, so he could get audio recording of him getting just terrible compromat on him for 45 minutes. And then the whole album was just like Trump like digging himself a hole over really sick beats, and that was going to be the record. But I don't think that's going to be the record. It's obviously always a big event when Kanye releases a record. And you know, Kim Kardashian put out this statement, and she is right. He's achieved some massive goals that he's had. So I don't think we'd be expecting anything subtle or, you know, anything short of being surprised by what he does release.
I think we will hear from him. I think there will be a release. I think he's done this before when he said it'll be, you know, 12 o'clock on Friday, and it eventually arrives a few days late or for whatever reason. So fingers crossed, and it'll be another interesting work, no doubt.
Yeah. Yes.
Could we have handled a Kanye release on the same day as a Taylor Swift one, Lizzie?
I'm sure we could have. It would have been very exciting. It would have been a lot of excitement for people who've maybe not had much in terms of celebrity news and music news and new releases to have two big hitters.
Who would have grabbed the proverbial mic on stage with those two releases coming out at the same time?
I know. That is actually interesting, Lizzie. You're talking about kind of showbiz and entertainment coming back to life again. Is there a feeling that the cultural world is, like Katie was saying, healing now? Because we've got the Tate reopening next week, haven't we?
We probably have the Tate reopening on Monday at 10 o'clock. So that's a good step. Yesterday, I went to the Pilates, owned by Andrew Lloyd Webber, and Beverly Knight, the singer, did a show, and it was really to show how live venues such as the Palladium can kind of come back and do increased hygiene measures and social distancing measures. And there was a lot of uplifting sentiment there yesterday, and it felt joyous, really, actually. But for the cultural industries in the UK, live performances, they still haven't got a date, which is becoming increasingly frustrating for a lot of people. And it's similar to what we heard from the pub industry and the gym industry and all of the industry. It'll be August the 31st. Okay, they can work towards that. And obviously these shows and these musicians, you know, you can't just drop everything and put on a show in 4 days or 5 days. It takes weeks. What they just need is a definite date from our government to say, this is when you're working for, and if that doesn't work out because there's a second spike or it's decided it's not safe, then they feel lost.
Yeah, there's been frustration on our side because, you know, there was this massive wave of pubs reopening and sports events, some people being able to sit in a row of six people on an aeroplane, and disappointing scenes of Soho being absolutely rammed, and they're saying, oh, we can't have gigs because shouting spreads coronavirus. It's like, oh, what? Yeah, no one shouts in a pub ever. Have you been to a pub? And then the other thing that, you know, I want to give a shout out to is the crew and the people who work around live music. And that's something I think that people have maybe got a bit of insight into during this time, is that it's not just about your Ellie Goulding's and Katy Perry's doing these huge shows and making tons of money. There's like over 200,000 people in the UK working in the live music industry, and a lot of those people are freelance. And the problem that we have is that if they're not given any assistance, they're gonna have to get other jobs. They just don't have a choice. And so even if we come back to it, we need people to be working in the venues and working at the sound desks and the lighting desks. Otherwise we can't do the show. So, and that's a really specialized workforce as well.
Katie, when will you feel safe to put on a show again?
Well, honestly, I was so gutted because I had a drive-in tour booked for September. So I was coming back to the UK in a couple of weeks to quarantine for a couple of weeks and then do the show. But it really, unfortunately, got cancelled. They were saying that local lockdowns were just making it impossible to know whether these shows were going to go ahead. So honestly, if I was given assurance that the proper steps were being taken in a venue to make sure people were safe, I would be up for playing. But we just need to know from a scientist, like what is safe and what should people be doing and how should this be done? And to be honest, it sounds like at the moment the safest situation would be for stuff to be outdoors. So, you know, there's that to consider as well. But I mean, this is the thing, there's no silver bullet, right? There's no answer. It's completely unprecedented territory and we don't know. And so we have to keep prioritizing people's safety.
So it's an outdoor arena tour for you next, is it, Katie?
Arena tour on my own. No one in the audience. We've just got to where are the holograms? Come on. We've got to get the holograms going. I want holograms of all the audience in the audience. Someone was actually telling me that it's not that far away with the technology, that you just actually, it's just a sheet of glass and a projector, and that you could literally be in your living room watching a hologram of your favorite artist playing. I mean, it's certainly not a live show, but, you know, there's, I think it's, you know, limitation breeds creativity. It always does. And I think that this is a really important moment for artistic people to become as creative as possible and keep that connection with their fans and come up with ideas of things to do. I'm getting on Patreon and doing a collage class with them soon. And like another fan taught us how to do Brazilian rhythm, and we're just getting together when we can. And that is an amazing kind of stopgap situation while we just have to work out how to handle it.
And that's The Leader. Pick up the newspaper for more on these stories, or you can keep up with all the latest news at standard.co.uk. Check out our Go London section for more on arts and culture. There's a review of Taylor Swift's new album there, 4 stars by the way, and a really interesting piece on what British artists are longing to see at the reopened Tate. The Leader podcast is back on Monday at 4 p.m.